If you want to use the rumors that appeal, welcome to the Dusty Wheel.
Hey, welcome back to the Dusty
If you want to use the rumors that appeal, welcome to the Dusty Wheel.
Hey, welcome back to the Dusty Wheel.
Hey, welcome back to the Dusty Wheel. I'm your host, the Innkeeper, and this is our live call and talk show all about the Wheel of Time. Tonight, we're talking about special effects, visual effects, and the Wheel of Time. But before I introduce my wonderful guest, I want to remind you about our next episode. Yes, tomorrow, we'll be right back here at the Dusty Wheel an hour earlier. That's 8 Eastern with Brandon Sanderson live. We'll be talking about the Wheel of Time and the rest of his works. I know a lot of people have been wondering how spoilers this is going to be. My goal is to have us talk about the Wheel of Time first. That will be a spoiler discussion, where it's questions about the books, you know, his writing of it. Then we will move on to his other works, and we will do our best to talk about non-spoiler things first, and then we will get to spoiler-like discussions and questions. We will do our best in that situation to only notify you when those things are going to happen. So if you're kind of curious, you want to know what's going to happen, just show up tomorrow, and like I said, we'll try to put banners up and make sure it's not spoiled for you. I can't guarantee chat won't be spoilerful, so just make sure you, if you don't want any spoilers at all when it comes to Brandon's other works, you check out or don't check out chat tomorrow night. So be back with us then. That's it. That's all I have to announce for you today. Without further ado, let me introduce my guest tonight, the Blue Man Group. No, I mean Lauren from Unraveling the Pattern. Lauren, how you doing, man?
I'm good. I lost some of my balls. excuse me. They keep falling off.
Your balls look nice. They look nice.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Now I can move around a little bit. If they fall off, it only adds to the comedic effect.
It does. It does. It does. Well, Lauren, thank you so much for being here tonight, man. You can strip that that mask off. I love it. Love it. Oh man, you can tell you were
glasses are all fucked up. It was worth it. It was worth it.
It was worth it. It was worth it. I mean, everybody, that's what you waited, honestly, for the last 15 minutes before the show. It was just the costume. Yeah. Oh man, there's going to be some great clips already coming from this show tonight. Well, for those of you that don't know anything about the Dusty Wheel, we do a live call and talk show. We discuss the Wheel of Time, and tonight we brought Lauren, who, beyond running an amazing YouTube channel, everybody loves Lauren's presentation of the Wheel of Time when it comes to graphics. If you don't follow Lauren, please go do that immediately after the show. You're going to love everything he's brought tonight, and you're going to love what you see over there. Your recent thing you did on the 101 history, so much fun. I love that thing. So thank you so much for the work and time you put into that. Why don't you explain to viewers right now, before we dive into, you know, basically special visual effects for dummies like me, why don't you explain to people kind of maybe your background, you know, what type of experience you have or don't have when it comes to the effects industry?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me, by the way. This is a lot of fun. I get really passionate about two things, the Wheel of Time and visual effects of movies, how they're made. So this is like all my favorite things coalescing into one great thing. So thanks for having me.
Absolutely.
So, you know, I wanted to start by talking a little bit about my qualifications. I'm going to strip this off even more. This is ridiculous. Yeah,
strip it all off. There's so many comments in chat right now, like, put your balls back on, your balls fell off.
So. You know how you get bed head? Well, I've got, like, bed beard or something. I don't know what that is.
Speak to your experience.
I started making videos when I was a teenager. Actually, I was 14, and I bought a VHS camera after working all summer, and that's how it all started. And I just fell in love with the movie making process at that point. And that was, you know, 1996, I want to say. So I was literally editing with VCRs, you know, like, nice. I didn't have a computer or anything like that. And since that time, things have improved a lot. And I remember there was this one time, my friends and I had heard about this thing called blue screen. And we're like, hey, you know what's blue? The sky is blue. Let's film ourselves in the sky and try to figure this out. So, you know, it was like my senior year, maybe I got a computer, and we attempted to use an old version of Premiere, and I managed to key out the sky in the background, and it was like the most amazing thing. But we were literally like up on the roof dancing, you know, like just to see if we could get the sky to key out. And in that process, I fell in love with the post-production process more so probably than the directing process. I think everyone, when they see movies like Star Wars or Lord of the Rings, they're like, I want to be a director. And I thought that too. And then, you know, I discovered I actually preferred making things in computers, making things from scratch. That's kind of where I found my interest. So anyway, one of the very first, if you can call it a visual effect, one of the very first effects we did when we were teenagers is I would set my camera up on a tripod in the hallway.
Okay.
You know that silly, like, goofy thing they do in cartoons all the time where the characters will, like, run into the room on the right and then they'll come out of the room on the left side of the hallway. And it's like, how did they do that? And so what we would do is we would set up the camera on a tripod. We would run through the room on the right, and then we'd run back out, stop the camera, rewind it, go into the room on the left, tell my friend to hit record, and then I'd come out of the room on the left. You know, that was like some of the very first, like, in camera VFX stuff that I did. And
that's so good.
Every movie I made in high school with my buddies had one of those scenes in it. Every single time. So
that is awesome. What did you end up, how did you, like, obviously that's the beginnings of Lauren and effects. Where did you take it from there when it came to, you know, college and your career?
Yeah, so when I started college, I majored in film studies. Media arts is what the major was called. Nice. And so I really just watched a lot of films for my degree, which is why I don't think my degree is worth much. But I ended up getting focused on editing. I took some jobs. I took a class for software called Adobe After Effects, which is actually the same class that I now teach today at the same university. I've been teaching that class for 15 years now. So yeah, so I just fell in love with the post-production process and everything. Now, what I do is actually called motion graphics, and it's a little bit different from visual effects. And we'll talk about some of those differences, but that's where I feel most comfortable animating graphics and effects and those types of things.
Where would you say your experience isn't then, you know, when it comes to talk about tonight?
So, you know, I feel like I know a lot about VFX, but I've never actually worked for, like, a big VFX studio. I've never, they have this very complex pipeline with all of that. And I'm kind of one of the people who messes with some of the stuff at the end of that pipeline. I don't have a lot of experience doing all of the things that motion capture, like this silly suit that I wear with the dots on it, right? Like, there's a whole team of people who do that, and I've never actually had experience with that. So when I say that I know VFX, I'm kind of like a fan of VFX who understands part of the process, but I wouldn't say that I have a lot of experience doing it. So,
gotcha. I mean, you were talking about, let me post this one. You're talking about the production pipeline. I know you have this kind of simplified concept. Do you want to speak to what the production pipeline is for people that are watching?
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, this is obviously very complex. One of the things that's amazing about Hollywood in particular and how they make films is they just, it's like a well-oiled machine, you know, it's like a very streamlined, like an assembly line. You know, everyone does their part and it goes down the assembly line. At the end of it, 2 years later, you've got a finished film, right? But, you know, all of that starts in pre-production. You have, like, your concept and you're thinking through it. And, you know, we've seen some really awesome concept art for the Wheel of Time show. a lot of that stuff probably came early on in that discovery and or pre-production phase. You've got things like script writing and all this other stuff. That's what pre-production is. It's coming up with the ideas, writing the scripts, and in the case of the first season of the show, casting, location scouting, all of the preparation. When it comes to like computer effects, there's also a lot of preparation that goes into that. They call it R&D, right? There's a lot of research and development, a lot of planning and testing and thinking through how is this going to work? Are we going to use practical effects here? We're going to use CGI here. And we'll talk more about that. Eventually though, you get to the point where you get to production. That's when they've scheduled the actors to be on set or on location with their camera crew, and it's go time. And it's kind of like the ticker tape is, it's like the taxi ticker is running. Every second they spend on set during production costs a lot of money. You have all these people there, huge team of people trying to make everything happen. And you know, they just, at that point, they just got to really have their act together, right? Then you have post-production, and post-production tends to be kind of this longer drawn out process where they sometimes fix things that went wrong in production. They sometimes have to, obviously they're doing editing and they're gathering all their footage and they're finding the best takes and they're doing all that. But eventually they have VFX. And what'll happen is at the end of, when they have like a rough cut of a episode, for example, then they'll identify.
I'm going to show that pipeline image that you had for that.
Oh, yeah.
Up on the screen here, which is showing that typical VFX pipeline. So yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so they'll identify, let's say they go, okay, for this first episode of The Wheel of Time, for the pilot episode, we have, I don't know, 100 shots that require VFX, maybe. And when I say VFX, you know, I'm talking about things that need to be added into the footage or taken out of the footage. And so then that VFX has its own pipeline, and they'll hire sometimes dozens of companies to work on individual shots. They'll hire hundreds of artists, and these people are working sometimes 100-hour weeks just to get these shots completed and approved by the director and then put into that rough cut until they eventually have a final cut where they're doing final mixing with sound and editing and music and, you know, like the final touches, the color correction and grading. So just VFX alone has this very complex pipeline where you have motion capture and texturing and 3D modeling and you know, simulation and adding in fire effects or magic effects in the case of The Wheel of Time. It's just so complex, all the stuff that goes into one shot.
Well, right? I think it was Gigieri that put out that list of all the companies that were part of that pipeline, if you will. I'm going to show, while you're talking and kind of continuing down, I'm going to show a couple of these demo reels as we go. But yeah, as Lauren's describing kind of that pipeline for VFX, you can kind of see some of the, you know, some of the skills from some of these companies, like, you know, for example, Cinesite, like this one. But yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so I love watching these because a lot of times they'll show you the final product, but they'll also kind of show you the different layers and the different things that go into it. And just for one shot, there's so much complex stuff that goes into it. And, you know, the visual effects that we enjoy as fans are big and loud, kind of like the stuff that you see in these demo reels. But then you have, like in Avengers, for example, like the Avengers movies and the Marvel movies, some of the effects in those things are just awesome to watch. But the truth is most VFX, I would say 90% of the VFX go unnoticed. You know, like a good VFX artist, if they're doing their job well, you don't notice that it's VFX. You know, things like replacing the top of a building in an incomplete set, or removing wires, or, you know, sign replacement. That's something that I've done quite a bit of. Just there's footage and they're like, oh, we can't show this sign in the background that's on that shop. We got to remove that sign. Like all these really tedious things that's kind of the reason I personally didn't go into VFX is, you know, A, I didn't really want to work 100-hour weeks.
Right, right.
But B, I like the stuff that's flashy and noticeable. And, you know, motion graphics does that. It's stuff that people notice. I'm like, ooh, that's cool. As opposed to if you do your job well, no one should notice. And, you know, you come out of a movie sometimes and you're like, ooh, the VFX in that were not good. You know, that's a bad thing, right? So...
Yeah, when I'm showing some of these companies that are, you know, working on the show, the work is amazing. Like I'm seeing some of these as you're talking, and I'm getting lost in the visuals of this. So, and because I know a lot of fans or and still are concerned, you know, like what's the quality of the show going to be like? When you've looked at some of these companies, how are you feeling about the answer to that question, you know, just from a quality standpoint?
Yeah, I'm so excited. I mean, they are sparing no expense from what I can tell. These companies are best of the best, top of the line. And I can't wait to see what they come up with. I have full confidence in them to do a great job.
Well, and Taylor was mentioning that he noticed that a lot of these companies they must work on these projects together, right?
You know. Yes.
And so why is that? I mean, like, why do you need 12 companies? You know, I'm sure people are asking that question. I don't know anything about the industry. You know, why do you need 12 in the pipeline?
Yeah, good question. I think I would imagine that they have a limited amount of time to get everything done, and they're just assigning shots to different companies. That's what I would guess.
Gotcha.
You know, okay. So it's probably, you'll, that's why when you watch these demo reels, they're showing individual little shots. And a lot of times those shots are parts of larger scenes, but sometimes they'll do a shot of, for example, the Incredible Hulk that appears here. And then five shots later, they'll do another shot of Incredible Hulk, but they won't do the four shots in between. That's another company that's been outsourced that. You know, I think there are other times when you may have experts that are doing certain parts of it. Like maybe there's one company that's really good at the 3D modeling and texturing, but there's another company that's really good at the motion capture and, you know, crowd simulation or whatever. So I'm guessing it's those two things. That's not something I'm a total expert on, but most likely those are the reasons. Yeah.
Yeah. And amazing companies. I mean, I've shown, you know, portions of four or five so far and just the work, of course. I mean, it's what they're showing you on some of their best of their best, but yeah, it's looking really good. You were talking about a specific idea of a lot of the work involved is like just taking out stuff in the background you don't want.
Right.
And I thought it might be an interesting place for us. I don't know if you want to kind of describe special effects and visual effects first, and then we can kind of show some of that work.
Yeah, so when I think of special effects, so a lot of people just use the term special effects to mean visual effects. But there is a difference. Special effects relates to stuff that's live on camera during shooting. For example, if you're shooting on set and you have fire and you want fire in the actual scene and you want the characters interacting with that fire, that would be a special effect. Someone is in charge of making that fire light. Someone is in charge of making sure that it doesn't burn the set down, that the actors are safe. That stuff's actually happening live while they're shooting. Fog effects are another example of this, you know, adding in fog and ambience and atmosphere. Special effects apply to makeup and puppets to some degree, or animatronics. It can apply to like blood effects. If someone has when they get shot and you can see the blood bursting off, they actually have these things called squibs that are, you know, they're set to charge and go off and make it look like they were shot, right? These are things that special effects people deal with. So I think of special effects as production phase in camera stuff.
Is it always a notion of, are you always saving money if you're doing, you know, special effects versus, you know, visual effects afterwards?
Yeah, good question. I don't know that you always are. And that's a really interesting thing, because these days, the way the visual effects industry works, like they're going for the lowest bid all the time. And so they're probably saving quite a bit of money doing things in post. However, we as an audience do tend to, we can kind of pick out things that were added later, you know, CGI.
Yeah.
And we'll get to this too, but Rafe has talked a lot about trying to keep things practical as much as possible. You remember when like the prequels to the Star Wars movies came out, and a lot of people reacted sort of negatively to the overabundance of shiny CGI effects.
Yeah, that's true.
Right. And so when the newer trilogy came out, the Skywalker trilogy, I think is what they call it, the latest three movies, they really bragged about, we're going to do more practical stuff. We're going to have more on-set droids and costumes and people in makeup that look like aliens and different creatures. I remember, especially with The Force Awakens, J.J. Abrams would like walk around the set and show people all these amazing animatronic creatures that they had built that were real, you know? We like that. It feels authentic. It feels more real to us. And so I don't know that it's necessarily cheaper or not. I think that depends, but it's definitely
more so the question of, yeah, it feels, especially that I'm sure different time periods, you know, when you're thinking about Star Trek, you know, you might expect it to feel, you know, almost surreal in some ways, whereas you want it to feel like very normal and gritty and, you know, lifelike. So you're, that makes sense. So then what's the difference then? So visual effects, how would you, you know, explain the difference between special and visual effects then?
Yeah. So you hope you'll hear people say CGI, like computer generated images. CGI or visual effects refers to adding things into that footage that was shot in production that wasn't there the day you shot it, or removing things that you don't want there. So for example, if you shoot someone on a green screen, you want to remove the green screen behind them and replace it with something else. That would be considered a visual effect, right? If you have Mark Ruffalo wearing this like weird looking motion capture Hulk suit that looks really goofy, and it's like styrofoam fists or whatever, right? Then the visual effects is going to come in and make it look like an actual Hulk is standing there instead of Mark Ruffalo in a suit.
Yeah, we got to show one of those. Yeah, bringing that up, I got to show some of those when you're talking about Mark Ruffalo in these suits. They're great.
They're somewhere.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
They almost look goofy, don't they?
Well, it's funny, and just seeing his face kind of. Almost out of like a cutout, you know, whatever that right. is. And he's just sitting there with this Hulk on his grip.
Well, and another thing that they've gotten really good at, they started doing this back during the Lord of the Rings movies. This is now 20 years ago, which is crazy to think about. You know, you had Andy Serkis playing Gollum, and they had him on set, and they had him running around like Gollum, and they had all these dots all over his face, and they were able to track all of that. And you know, he gave an amazing performance, and you could really feel the performance in Gollum's character, even though it was all CGI. And it's because they were tracking the actual actor's face and stuff. And now they've gotten much better at that. You know, that's almost commonplace now. Even characters like Vision in WandaVision or in some of the other Avengers movies, he'll be wearing some prosthetics that look like his suit, but then they'll have dots all over it too to add CGI elements later to make it look kind of more otherworldly or whatever. So
yeah, so they can.
It's kind of amazing the things they can do.
Yeah, the mixing of those two is really it's really cool. I love that. Now, for those that are kind of watching, we can talk through some of these examples that you put together. You know, I mean, everyone's familiar with the Matrix, I think. Yeah. You know, so maybe I can show. You know, this scene of the Matrix is where Neo and Agent Smith they're fighting in the subway. And they jump in the, you know, in the air, and they have this really cool scene, you know, obviously trying to shoot each other. But definitely some of my, I love The Matrix, you know, and I love these movies. And I love all the effects in them. But one of the images that you sent me to kind of show the, you know, people see that and they're just, you know, amazed. And this is the work I think you're talking about, which is, you know, all the wire work that they're on. I mean, literally when you... Maybe explain that. Maybe explain that idea of removing. Like, what is the process of removing the wires from the image? Is it literally like each frame you're going in and doing what?
Yeah. So, I mean, this is why they shoot it on green screen. It certainly makes it easier because, and there's things called masks or mats that can be used to improve. Oh, yeah. This image. So, this image here. One of the things that I like to point out about this image, aside from the wires. You can see in the green screen, you see all these holes everywhere.
Yeah, yeah.
And for the Matrix, what they actually did is they had a camera from every one of those holes pointing at the scene so they could do that rotation around the characters. It's not a single camera shooting that. It's a bunch of cameras shooting it all, you know, side by side. And it gives them the ability to make it look like they're freezing in air while the camera's moving around them. It's kind of insane how they did that. So this is one of the things I love too, is things like wire removal. That stuff is probably easy these days for VFX artists. The way I would do it is by using masks and some keying stuff. It requires a bit of frame by frame work, but not a ton.
I'm sure that's evolved. I'm sure it was much more tedious maybe than it ever is now.
Certainly. I don't know if the clip is there, but there's this clip from this old show from the 90s called The Young Indiana Jones Chronicles. I don't know if you have that clip.
Ooh, it's not the rotoscoping one. I don't think I have the Chronicles one.
That's okay. It's a rotoscoping one. I'll have to post that on.
Is it the rotoscoping one?
It is the rotoscoping one.
Yeah, I can throw that one up there. Go ahead.
Oh, you do have that one.
Yep.
What I love about this one is they show this, it's like a 4-second shot. It's not a big deal. But there was an actor that was in the shot that they had to remove. I don't know why. Maybe for legal reasons, he no longer wanted to be in the shot or something. I don't know why. But they had to remove this guy. And they have this thing called a rotometer in the bottom right. And you can see it counting up past 3,000 hours of work.
Is that what that is?
That's what that is.
No way.
And this is because they probably had to somehow do this in camera. They were probably painting over the top of the guy in the shot frame by frame until they could get it perfect. I mean, you know, there's a guy standing in the background behind that actor.
Yeah, that's insane.
It's insane. So rotoscoping is a term that is used to refer to painting out or frame by frame removing or cutting out certain things. So imagine, you know, taking a single image of someone and tracing around them and getting a really nice clean edge around them. But then imagine doing that 24 frames a second for 20 seconds or 30 seconds. Like, that's a lot of tedious work. And so, you know, people who start out in the VFX industries often are doing rotoscoping because it's kind of like the bottom of the barrel production assistant kind of stuff, right? Wow. It's tedious. No one wants to do it. And there are obviously tools these days that make all of that easier. But I like showing that clip in particular because 3,000 hours of work for like a 4-second clip is just insane. Probably would have been cheaper to get all the actors back together and reshoot the scene. But for whatever reason, the budget didn't allow for that, you know, and so that's what they ended up with. So,
well, I'm gonna remind you, let's take just a quick break. I remind everybody, please do like this video while you're watching us talk all about this. Like I said, go check out Lauren's channel after this. Please do subscribe to his channel. He does amazing work. He takes all this experience and he applies it to basically, teaching the Wheel of Time basically introducing and talking about concepts visually. And it's so compelling. Yeah, I love it. And you do a lot of great work when it comes to just telling the right story. So please make sure you do that. We'd love to have you here. If you're not already subscribed, please do. And I'll remind everybody that's watching over on Facebook and Twitter, hopefully you enjoyed this first half of the show. Come enjoy the rest of it over here on YouTube. This will be the end of your, you know, sneak peek into what we're talking about. We're going to cover all of Rafe's questions and answers all about VFX and special effects that fans have asked over the last, I don't know, year and a half here now or 2 years, and kind of break those down with Lauren. We're going to be showing lots more examples of the companies that are involved here. You know, so just some examples. I want you to come over here because Lauren's going to have us do like this little quiz on what our skills are like when it comes to whether or not we can detect what's real and what's fake, I think. So,
yeah,
please come on over, like I said. But thank you very much for joining us over on Facebook and Twitter. Just type in YouTube and the Dusty Wheel. You'll find us over there. So thank you. Now, Lauren, there is a second one here. I thought we'd show it really briefly. It's the Inception scene.
Yeah.
So those of you that have seen Inception here, same kind of thing. I just want to show this in addition to what we had already talked about. We have the scene where, you know, I can't remember the characters here, but they're kind of getting wrapped up and they're moving, almost seeming like they're floating, you know, down this hallway. And it's a great scene. Now, the image that you sent me to kind of show everyone here is, yeah, just the contraptions, you know, all of the stuff right. that they use to create that effect. And so obviously, I know I'm going to use my effects 101 for dummies here. This would be a special effect and a visual effect afterwards, right? Because they're pulling everything out in post, but they're creating the effect or the illusion of floating in the midst of filming it here.
Right, exactly. So special effect meaning they did all this practically. This is something that Christopher Nolan, who directed this film, he absolutely loves practical effects, meaning doing it in camera on the set. As a matter of fact, for this scene, there's a point when I can't remember his name, but Joseph Gordon-Levitt's character in Inception is fighting these other guys in the hallway as the gravity is shifting, as it's like turning. And they built this giant hotel room hallway rig that rotates for that scene so that the gravity is literally shifting as they're fighting each other. And you know, that was all done in camera. The only thing they had to remove was some of the wires that were holding them up so that the actors wouldn't get hurt. Or in this case, trying to fake, you know, no gravity, whatever. So it's kind of just insane to see what can be accomplished when you have a budget. I mean, you know, Inception, I think, had like a $200 million budget or something. So I guess they can get away with it, right?
Yeah. So before we jump into tackling, you brought some questions from fans about, you know, the industry and the Wheel of Time and Rafe's questions. I want to do this last thing. You had this note here. I don't know, maybe explain what this quiz is going to be, and then we'll show this video.
Sure. So, okay. You know, I because I teach an Adobe After Effects class and I'm teaching students about, you know, how these things are done, I like to show different clips to kind of show, you know, it's the mundane stuff in television that you don't think about, that CGI. Like I say, the best VFX are the ones no one ever notices. So I have this little clip here. This is actually from a show from like 2011, from a show called Ugly Betty, which is not a thing. Yeah, I don't know if you have that up.
Yeah, I can put it. So this is the quiz, right? This is the quiz.
Yeah, this is the quiz. So this is the is the setup here. You know, so in Ugly Betty, which is not a show I have ever watched, you would think, okay, they shoot all this with a camera. There's probably no effects in this. Okay. So if you watch this clip, I kind of want people in chat to guess what percentage of this shot do you think is visual effects, meaning done in post after they shot it? And what percentage of this shot do you think is done in camera?
I don't know. It does have a little green screen effect here, it feels like. So I'm going to say it feels like there's a green screen as she's walking out. It could be.
Yeah, especially there. Those people in the background, so, right? Those two ladies that are standing there. There's something about those two ladies that feels like maybe they weren't there originally, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, but for the most part, I mean, I would say, like, if I didn't know better watching a show, I would just go, oh, yeah, this is just shot on a street somewhere. Right. Because okay, that's another thing. We're watching it loop. Right. But when you're watching a TV show, you don't watch it loop. And so it happens. Right. It's done and it's over with. It was 3 seconds and you move on. So,
okay. I showed the loop. I'm showing the loop one more time here. Here we go. I'm seeing some answers. Okay.
15% digital, 20% effects. Okay.
Yeah, 80% post by Daniel. Okay. So, you want me to show the reveal now?
So, you show the reveal and it will also show the same clip as well. So,
gotcha. Okay.
It's kind of mind-blowing to me how much of this clip is not real. When I say not real, I mean not shot at the same time as the foreground. Oh, was that was that the same one?
It's basically everything.
Yeah. Is this,
yeah. So I'm just showing the reveal here again.
Okay, here we go. Yeah, there's a bit of a delay. Yeah, okay. So basically everything. Now, interestingly, they did put a piece of glass there so that her reflection would show up when she's
in the window. Sure.
But other than that, I mean, nothing in that shot hardly is from the original shot. So anyway.
Yeah, if you're not trying to pay attention to that, you know, you're not like staring at it. Yeah, you probably wouldn't have even noticed. You know?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So one of the companies that's working on the Wheel of Time is Stargate Studios. And they do a lot of work like this. It's kind of the mundane background, regular TV show junk that there's nothing super exciting about it. It's just kind of mundane stuff. There's a demo reel of that. I don't know if you have that one.
I don't see Stargate. I'm not sure why I don't see Stargate here, but.
Oh, that's okay. There's a demo reel from them from 2012, which is where this clip comes from. And it just shows these random shots from shows that were popular at the time, like Ugly Betty and Grey's Anatomy. And it's just shocking to me how often they're using green screens to save money on regular TV shows that probably don't have very high budgets. And so,
anyway. That makes sense. I mean, that makes sense. That's a cool way to kind of enter, kind of get a feel. Hopefully everyone's enjoyed this first half of us just talking about the processes and, you know, what we're talking about here. But I like that you pulled in some questions from fans and Rafe's stuff here. I think this is a fun part to kind of turn towards the Wheel of Time and start talking about that. Did you want to cover the questions from the fans first or Rafe's questions?
Let's do a question from the fan.
Okay. Our first one here comes from Brother Dan. Mm-hmm. Brother Dan asks, I'd like to hear more specifics about your Amazon breakdowns as far as how you can see what may be added afterwards or some other computer CGI things you can spot that maybe I can't. Yeah, there's times where I'll see you in chat when we'll do the live coverage of the news. And you'd be like, that's obviously this. Oh, did you see this thing? And I'm thinking, no, I didn't see that thing. So yeah, maybe speak to the answer of this question for Brother Dan.
Yeah. So on top of the, you know, I do sort of teach Wheel of Time on my YouTube channel. I have Watt 101. But on top of that, whenever there's a teaser, I try to do like a breakdown and I try to find little details that hopefully no one else noticed. But along with that comes speculation. And so I have to be honest, 100% of the time, I don't know. I I'm guessing a lot of the time. In the case of the, like the Trolloc leak, where we saw the imagery of the Trolloc, I was sure that there was quite a bit of CGI and compositing going on there. And when I say compositing, I mean, so eventually you have to take all those elements, like the green screen footage and the shot of the guy in the background and the shot of Moraine in the foreground and all that stuff, and you have to compile it all into a final shot that looks like a single shot instead of six different elements put together or whatever. And so I was sure that in the case of the Trolloc one in particular, oh yeah, that's got to be composited. That's a final shot. That's part of the final show. And you know, we'll talk about this later, but Rafe did kind of shut me down on that one a little bit. So
yeah,
so I don't know that I know that
one. Yeah, I have some questions about that when we get there. So but how do you, like, what is it you're looking for, you know, that maybe those of us that are not in the know might look for next time if we really want to try to inspect where we might catch?
Yeah, it's kind of like you're unblurring videos. It just takes a level of insanity and looking at it over and over, frame by frame, and staring at it until you start to see pictures, right? Like, there is an element of that. Or I'm just looking at it and going, oh, what's that in the top left corner? Oh, what's this? You know, I do use like contrast and other things sometimes to kind of bring out the levels and try to find things that maybe aren't in the original shot as easy to see in the darkness or whatever. But I think really at the end of the day, it's probably just because when I watch movies, I pay attention to these things because that's what I do during the day. And so I maybe just have an eye for it because of experience, not necessarily because I'm great at it or something.
Can you not watch a movie and look for it at this point? I mean, that's just so much part of your life.
Yeah. I mean, that's how I know it's a great movie, is when I stop paying attention to that because I'm just pulled in, because the story or the acting or whatever is so good that I forget, oh, I should be watching the effects. Nice. But often I'm watching the effects, you know, like Doctor Strange or something. I love that movie just for the spectacle of it.
Yeah, that's for sure. I watched it again the other day. I agree. Yeah, the spectacle of it is amazing.
Yeah.
Now, this next question comes from Glenn. And Glenn asked, how common has it become to blend practical and CG effects together for one thing, such as the whites, zombies in Game of Thrones and Walking Dead? And do you expect similar work for Trollocs, especially to animate their features? Do you expect the faces of fades to be prosthetics or CG produced? And which do you think would end up being cheaper to do? A variety of questions in that one.
Yeah, I think the cheaper to do question is, I've kind of already addressed that. Like, I don't always know when it's cheaper. I think getting super detailed close-ups of CGI faces is never the best idea if you can avoid it. I was watching in preparation for this, a making of video with how they do the Hulk and the latest version of the Hulk, where they have like the smart version of the Hulk in Endgame. They have like the pores in his skin moving based on his smiling and talking. I mean, they really got granular with the detail. That's extremely expensive, I'm sure. In the case of Wheel of Time, my guess is the fades and the Trollocs are going to be 90% practical, and you're going to have wide shots where they'll have like CGI add-ins. A lot of times they'll use CGI to like fill in the background. You know, you'll have three or four actors in prosthetics kind of in the foreground with the face detail and everything, but then they'll just want to fill in like an army in the background. That's where the CGI comes in. So I would guess that's how they're going to do the Wheel of Time. I hope we see some epic battle scenes. There's a great scene in The Eye of the World, and I don't know if we're allowed to talk spoilers here.
Yeah, so that's a good point. You know, while we're finally to the Wheel of Time here, we can go ahead. We're not going to look to spoil the entire books or anything. We're probably going to stick to talking about The Eye of the World and The Great Hunt. So if you're here, Lauren and I will agree that we're not going to go to the end of the books. But if you don't want anything from The Eye of the World potentially spoiled or The Great Hunt, just be warned that while this banner is up, that might happen. So yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so I was going to say there's a battle scene that happens quite quickly before they enter Shia Gul in the first book. And I hope that they make that scene really epic. I hope that they have CGI Trollocs in the background and it just feels like they're overwhelmed, you know. But I don't know. I don't know how they're planning on doing that or if they're even going to include that in the first season. I think one of the things, and we'll get into this too with Rafe's questions, they're constantly concerned about the budget. And I think in the case of a first season show, you kind of have to prove to Amazon or Sony or whoever's making it that you can do it and keep it in budget so that hopefully it gets popular and you get more budget for the next season. You know what I mean? So they're constantly having to pick and choose what to include and what to take out in order to fulfill that budget. So I would guess they're going to save some of their big budget moments for battle scenes and definitely like one power effects and that sort of thing. But it is common. It's so common that I think we'll be surprised to find out in the making of stuff after the show comes out just how much of it was CGI or at least filled in background stuff, you know?
Yeah, I can't wait till we have some of these same images for the Wheel of Time. That's just really fun. Well, why don't we do that? I mean, we've kind of been teasing jumping into Rafe's questions. Let's jump into this first question. Rafe has been answering questions on Instagram and Twitter. I didn't mark where these questions were at, but you can go and find them in a variety of places, probably just through the Wheel of Time account or Rafe's account. Or WattSeries.com is going to have, you know, backup of all of those things that happened. This first question from Rafe that we have here was, how much of the Monster Trolloc Fade Drakkar design is being done practically versus digital effects? Mostly makeup and prosthetics? And with that, how closely does the design match the text? Totally smooth faces as fades, varieties of Trollocs, etc.? And his answer was, we have worked hard to use as many practical effects and pieces as possible for Trollocs and fades, but don't want to spoil all the secrets until you watch the behind the scenes after the first season. So, yeah, what did that tell you? He mentioned pieces. Yeah, effects and pieces. Is that that whole like Hulk thing that we're talking about? In other words, like there is a piece that they include, and then the rest they're kind of like using, you know, visual effects afterwards to add.
Yeah, I have to say, first of all, how exciting is it that there's going to be a BTS, like a behind the scenes thing? I haven't purchased DVDs in a long time, but I'll probably be getting Blu-rays of Wheel of Time so that I can watch all the features and behind the scenes stuff. That's very exciting. So I would say that a good indication of probably where they're going with Wheel of Time is Carnival Row, which is a Amazon show as well. And they have the same like lead makeup designer, the same guy who did a lot of the really great prosthetics and creature effects for Carnival Row, is doing the Wheel of Time. And we have some examples of that that I think we can show at some point.
Yeah, I'm throwing that up there, but yeah, you can go ahead and keep talking.
And I would highly recommend just looking up, his name is Nick Dudman, D-U-D-M-A-N. I would highly recommend looking up his website and going and checking out his gallery. He has some really incredible like makeup and prosthetic stuff work that he's done. He's been working on films since like, he worked on like 1989 Batman movie with the Tim Burton Batman.
Yeah, that's crazy, right?
You know, and he worked on Star Wars, some of the original Star Wars stuff, and like he's really been involved with some amazing prosthetics that many of us will recognize. Harry Potter, his work is all over Harry Potter, the Harry Potter movies. So to have him on the Wheel of Time is very exciting to me. And seeing some of his Carnival Row work, it's really interesting to see some of the behind the scenes stuff. For example, they have these sort of like what are they called? The characters that are like man above and then horse, the body of a horse,
or a
centaur or something like that. They have that, and sometimes you can see that there are parts of them that are clearly like a rig that hold their body up. That's the kind of stuff that has to get painted out, right?
Gotcha.
And so again, 90% of it is
even like the horns. You can see, you can imagine some of those horns are going to come into play.
Absolutely, you know. Yeah. They obviously, I almost feel like Carnival Row is just kind of like practice for the Wheel of Time, right?
Yeah, that's a good.
They've got the horns, and they've got some of these larger creatures and characters. There's one shot on his website of this like huge dude that's got to be wearing stilts or something, and there's a green screen behind him, and I just love that. I love that idea of Trolloc makeup, you know, like people in suits. I feel like that's going to be the most real. And so, yeah, I think they're doing the right thing by making it practical most of the time.
Yeah, I mean, again, somebody that talented, if you go check out, I mean, I'm going to throw some images up of Nick's work. If you go check this out, you can just see, like, yeah, I mean, this is Carnival Row, but I mean, look at this stuff. This comes from back in the day. I mean, there's Jack Nicholson.
Yeah.
And then I'm trying to think of, you see Harry Potter here. You see some Star Wars, you know, it's cool to know that someone this capable, talented, and part of work that we've already come to enjoy is part of the show. I do want to show this one it shows kind of that, what I think is more, which makes me excited to see kind of the Drakkar, assuming they have that. They won an award for Penny Dreadful. And so I'm showing on the screen right now, the kind of the clip that they show at the award ceremony, and I think that they won this one. And you can just see this creature. It's I don't know. It just it speaks to me like a Drakkar, you know.
Yeah. And I have to say, if you want to get hyped up for the level of quality that we'll see in the show related to Shadowspawn, look at Nick Dudman's website. It got me so excited, more so than I've been to date.
Yeah.
But yeah, this clip is incredible.
It's awesome. Yeah, and that, like I said, that creature. It's exciting to again know that someone that skilled and that used to bringing like really renowned work to the screen is part of the project. So
exactly,
I do want to jump on to our second question here from to Rafe. Let's try that one. This one was, what would you say the CGI to practical ratio is going to be? His answer was, trying to do as much in camera as we possibly can. This is, you know, kind of repeating what he was saying before, you know, driving on this idea that they really want to do as much practical effects as they can, which again makes sense. And again, what we are hoping for, I think, as fans. Let me jump to this third question, because that was kind of just a continuation of a thought he had. Now we get to this question, though, about Trollocs. Loved the first look at the Trollocs. When are we getting more? And Rafe said, sadly, there hasn't been a first look at the Trollocs yet. That was some accidentally leaked raw footage. We work hard to make the show. It's always a shame when you guys see stuff outside the way we have it planned. I'll tell you one thing. When I met with directors for season 2, who had seen the pilot, they all had one thing to say. Those Trollocs. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, what did you think about this answer? You know, for those of you that are watching, if you didn't see it, there were some leaked footage. We did a whole live coverage on it. Lauren did a whole breakdown of that. Mm-hmm. When he says raw footage, I don't really understand what he's talking about. Yeah. Do you have an idea of what that is?
Well, I'll say that this is definitely Rafe being careful. And I think that's good. And I think he's very good about, you know, they said, what's the ratio of CGI to practical? And he says, we're doing as much in camera as we can. That's not answering the question, right? But it's a good answer. I mean, he wants to give us hope without getting too nitty gritty on the details. Now, when I use the term raw footage, and I've always heard it used this way in my career, that refers to when you hit record with your camera or, you know, your film is rolling, whatever you get, that's raw footage. It hasn't been processed. It hasn't been edited. You haven't even gone through and picked the takes. You haven't added any effects or anything. And so I think he's being a little bit misleading here when he says that was accidentally leaked raw footage. I think what he means is maybe like rough footage or early unfinished footage. But in my mind, there's no way that that was raw footage. And I broke that down in detail in my Trolloc breakdown video.
So you're basically, yeah, like likely he meant kind of this was something that wasn't ever meant to see the light of day.
Right.
Like, and I get a lot of people were thinking that was the Trolloc, and he was saying, you haven't seen Trollocs yet. Like this was it almost sounds like he's saying like it was just something we put there to kind of see how it would look. I don't know. Like,
yeah, maybe. Or it was always meant to be there in the background, but it was never meant to be released as a marketing thing. Because, and I mentioned this as well in my breakdown, this is the kind of thing that we will pick apart when we're given 3 seconds. We're going to pick that thing apart frame by frame. Sure. But when you're watching an entire sequence of, you know, the Winter Night Battle, for example, and you see the Trollocs flooding into Emmons Field and you see Moraine and Lan burst out of the inn and they're like, Trollocs in the village. And the like half drunken villagers are like, what's going on? And like that whole sequence and the intensity of it, I think you're not going to pay attention when there's a little blurry furry Trolloc in the background of one shot, because they're probably going to be showing close-ups of menacing Trollocs. They're going to be showing fades in the shadows, and they're going to be building this suspense. So I think he's right to say, you know, it's a shame when you guys see stuff outside the way we have it planned. That was meant to be seen in a sequence, not as a teaser. And I think that's why they chose to go with the close-up of Moraine's face in the original teaser instead.
Well, I mean, and going back to the answer to that question, he said the directors were like Trollocs, those Trollocs. So it sounds like we're going to be getting, like you said, lots of close-ups. We're going to be feeling that same thing that those directors were feeling, which was they saw the pilot and they were like, Trollocs, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So
that's a cool thought, which is, you know, as much as we all kind of believe that that's going to be, you know, Beltane and the attacks happening, the attack does seem to be centered around who's doing the attacking. you know, and that's going to be a standout of that scene, which I think is exciting.
And I really, there are horror elements to the Wheel of Time that we sometimes don't realize because it's kind of just like an adventure story for us. But
right.
I think, you know, that Penny Dreadful clip is a great example of bringing the horror elements of the Shadow Spawn. Like, these are freaky creatures. And if the Trollocs aren't menacing and scary right up front, then we're not going to care if Rand and his friends are running from them. So they have to make them, they have to make people say, wow, those Trollocs, right? That has to stand out. And so I feel like that's what they're doing. I'm very excited about that.
Yeah, me too. Now, this next question does touch on, you know, what some fans are either disappointed about or they were hoping they were going to see, you know, more of this. The question was, the statement, I guess, was, that doesn't look ageless. Is this something that is being reworked? And Rafe's answer was, VFX that require you to touch every frame that a character appears on screen are not great uses of money. So don't expect to see CGI faces for all the Aes Sedai. Which I thought was, again, he's using some Aes Sedai type language there. we're not going to be spending that much money where we're going to try to address this across all Aes Sedai, which tells you a couple things. There's going to be a lot of Aes Sedai, right? That's what he's suggesting, right? Is that would cost way too much money to apply it to all the Aes Sedai, but maybe some. And so that... Again, people are kind of assuming that he was saying there's not going to be anything ageless about any of the faces as far as an effect, and I don't necessarily think that particular answer is saying that.
Right. I completely agree. I think this was a great answer from Rafe. He's just pointing out the obvious, which is there are things that we have to sacrifice in the show. That means not every Aes Sedai is going to have that ageless face. What even is an ageless face? I mean, we could talk about that for days. Yeah. Like, that's up to interpretation. So I think it's very wise of him to say that. It's frame by frame stuff that's so costly. There are going to be characters like Rosamund Pike is going to be in a lot of scenes. They don't want to go through and touch up her face in every single scene. That's a waste of resources. I would rather see them put that money into better one power effects, you know, or better CGI Trollocs if they need them in the background of certain shots or that sort of thing. That's what I would rather see. So yeah. I think this is a great answer. I'm totally on board with this.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. Now, this next one I think might also be along that same vein of answers that were, you know, this had to do with Moiraine's staff. You know, this one was happened to be though about Lan's cloak. The question was, will Lan's cool cloak be featured in the show? Rafe's answer was, I love Lan's cloak in the show, but much like Aes Sedai agelessness, if it's an effect that's going to cost a fortune every time a character's on screen, it's a bad use of our money. Unless you want to see all of season one in the Wine Spring Inn, then you have then you can have color changing cloaks. Now this is one of those things I think we could see something of in future seasons.
Yeah,
you know, more budget. Maybe we don't need the initial budget to pay for all the kind of startup costs, if you will, for all the things they're doing, and maybe they, you know, all of a sudden they give us a cloak later on. But yeah, I'm on board with this one. The cloak itself isn't actually used that often in the books anyway. Yeah. it's an interesting point, but it kind of goes away a bit. So this one doesn't... it sounds to me like we might get more agelessness than color-shifting cloaks. That is to say that they may use some of that money. That's kind of how I interpret those last two answers.
Yeah, especially in season one. Like you say, this leaves the door open for so much more. Again, the show has to do well. They have to put their focus and their money in the right things for season one. And then it will open some doors. And, you know, the dragons in the last seasons of Game of Thrones were extremely expensive CGI things. I'm but sure. The first few seasons really didn't have hardly any of that. I think... Season one, you had a little bit of dragon stuff in the end, but I mean, you know, we'll get there. That's the hope.
Yeah. No, agreed. Okay, this last question that we're going to cover to Rafe was, how are you planning to handle the visualization of the weaves? Any little tidbits? His answer was, we are trying to stay as true to the books as possible. I've been giving a bunch of VFX folks long diatribes about channeling weaves, threads, earth versus air, etc., and the early stuff has started coming in. It looks effing awesome. I screamed when Rosamund started channeling. So that's great. I'm going to go back to that answer. He said, we're trying to stay as true to the books as possible. You know, and that is, he also had another answer about this of like, would everyone see is everyone will be able to see the weaving or mm-hmm. something like that? And he said something like that, well, if you will if you can channel something to that, you know. What do you think about this idea of channeling? Do you think this is going to be the kind of make it or break it for people when it comes to the CGI, the special effects of the series?
Yeah, you know, I think general fans, especially people who aren't fans of the books, they'll probably be happy with whatever they come up with. I think as fans, we might be a little picky. But this is the stuff that I am looking forward to. This is the stuff I want them to put all the budget in when it comes to VFX. This, it's like that Doctor Strange stuff. It's the spectacle of it. That's the stuff I want to see. Whether or not we see weaving all the time, I think there will be times when we do. But I mean, I cannot wait to see this. And this is a good time to mention, this is when special and practical, or practical special effects and VFX are going to absolutely work together. They're going to have a VFX coordinator on set to be sure that things, for example, when Moraine channels air, you have to see the effects of that wind on the people around her. So they'll have to have people with fans blowing wind around, right?
Right,
so that's special effects, the wind blowing, the atmospheric stuff that's happening around with fog or whatever, people's hair whipping around. But then the VFX, it's almost silly. If you've ever seen like behind the scenes stuff of Scarlet Witch, you know, from WandaVision or from the, I keep mentioning the Avengers movies, but I've been watching them a lot recently. Yeah, so they're on right now in my mind. You know, they show the actress doing these silly things with her hands. And it's like, what is she doing? And she even says in some of the behind the scenes stuff, she feels kind of silly because she's just like making all these hand movements and nothing's actually happening. Then when you watch the movie and all this cool magical stuff comes out of her hands, it feels very natural and it's fine. But I think that's what the, you know, the actors in the show are dealing with. They may be seeing the effects of something like something getting knocked over, for example, you know, or fire suddenly springing up somewhere. That's a special effect, but there's so much VFX that will be added to that to enhance it.
Yeah. And I mean, and this is something you mentioned, that post-production is, I'm sure there's not a formula, maybe there is, but you know, if it takes whatever, 9 months to shoot, you know, like, and you're, you know, you have this kind of fantasy element, how long is that in post-production? It seems like that's where they're spending a lot of time. And obviously with the time that we got because of everything that's been happening across the world, I'm hoping that that was a lot of time to do post-production and get it right. You know, right. They didn't have to rush it, right? They had time to maybe try different things and see what they like work. So that's what I'm excited about is I'm hoping that that time that they got and they still have is going, it was put to good use.
Yeah, I don't know if this is wrapping up the discussion, but to kind of put it in perspective, one time we had this new employee come to work for us. He had just moved from California. He had been working in the VFX industry, working on some pretty big budget TV shows and movies. And he was sick of it because he was working so many hours and he was so tired of it. And he wanted to start a family, settle down. So he came to work for my small company here in Utah, which is, you know, we have 20 employees and we make medical animations. It's pretty low key. You know, we do corporate work. And it's nice 40-hour work week, you know. And so I remember talking to him. I was saying, hey, my family started watching this show called Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And we started watching season 2. And he's like, oh, yeah, I worked on that. And I was talking. I was like, oh, some of the VFX in one of these episodes was just awful. And I was talking about this. And then he literally was like, oh, I worked on that episode. Like, and I realized in this moment, like, real people are working on this stuff. And most of the time, they're up against a deadline and they're just doing the very best they can. And sometimes you get what you get, especially when it's on TV or in movies. It has a fixed deadline and it's out for public and they don't change it after that, unless you're George Lucas with the auditions, right? So I think that that kind of put things into perspective. And then, you know, looking at all these companies and all the people that work on these things help put things in perspective for me, because it's like, there are literally hundreds, sometimes thousands of people working on VFX for a movie or TV show. So many artists, so many cooks in the kitchen trying to get all these different shots done. And you know what? Some of the shots aren't going to be as good as others. And so I think as fans, we probably shouldn't judge a show based on a few shots.
Okay. Okay, Mr. Wiggate.
Yeah. Oh, wait. What? Yes.
Mr. Wiggate. If you haven't seen Lauren's Wiggate video, that's a great one. It's like 2 to 3 minutes long, maybe as long as that, but If you have no idea what I'm talking about, I won't ruin it. Just go check out Unraveling the Pattern, look up Wiggate. Now, I want to make one final point, and then I want to move to the third part of our discussion, which is talking about the show and kind of what you and I are excited about. I'm going to open the call lines here shortly if you guys want to give us a call. You can comment on anything that Lauren has mentioned, you know, or if you have a question for him just about the process, or, you know, you've seen some of these demo reels and you're really excited. But you were talking about that one rotoscope one video that we mentioned earlier, and the 3,000 hours. And I love this graphic you sent me. And I want you to kind of speak about this, because it seems mind-blowing. But if you stay at the end of some of these movies, it makes some sense here. But showing this graphic of how many artists worked on a variety of well-known movies. I mean, Iron Man 3, 1960. I'm not even sure I can understand, like, what are they all doing? I mean, it's, right. Some of it's what you told us today, I'm sure, but that seems unbelievable.
It does, but at the same time, I mean, backgrounds, for example, just building like a street in the background and adding building to that. Someone has to make every window of every building that's fake in the background. You know, someone has to make the glass in the windows look real. Someone has to make the bricks in the walls of that house look real. And that's just a house in the background of a scene. That's not like character animation and motion capture and all this other stuff. I mean, it really is complex. And this is why I say, you know, Hollywood, it's this well-oiled machine. You couldn't do this if it wasn't efficient. You know, yeah. They definitely have it figured out to a point where they've got studios competing for their business. And somehow these Hollywood movies still act like they're not making a profit. And so they don't always pay the way they should. And there's a lot of controversy there. But man, yeah. I mean, really. And I read that when doing research for this, Game of Thrones had like 20 different companies over the course of its 7 seasons. Something like 2,500 artists worked on Game of Thrones.
Oh, my gosh.
And that's just for VFX. That's not including concept art, pre-visualization, and a lot of other things that go into it. So... amazing.
That is, and I've seen some people say, like, I think the Matrix one seems like artificially low, maybe, but again, a lot of these studios did some of this, they probably couldn't afford to pay, you know, it doesn't show how many hours each of these artists worked, and that might be a fun kind of mix of those two numbers, which is artists and hours, because you could have 1,900 that maybe aren't working 40-hour weeks, and then you might have 135 that are working 80-100-hour weeks.
So, easy, yeah.
So I want to remind everybody, like hopefully you all know, this is a live call-in talk show. That's right. You can give Lauren and I a call here at 1-313-825-5968 or 1-313-TALK-WATT, and we'll answer your questions. Obviously, I'm not going to answer anything for you about the industry. I don't know anything about it. But I will geek out with you and be excited about what we have coming up here if you want. So, yeah, feel free to give us a call. And while you decide to call us, there's no one in queue just yet if you want to be that first person. I want to talk to you, Lauren, about what you're excited about when it comes to the special effects and the visual effects and the Wheel of Time. Like, what's really kind of keeping you up at night and you can't wait to see it?
Well... I've talked about this a little bit as well on some other platforms with other people, but I am very looking forward to how they do the One Power weaves in particular. I don't know how much of that we'll see this season because, you know, characters may not be seeing weaves, but at some point they're going to go into the White Tower. At some point we're going to see training. We're going to see hopefully different characters learning how to use the One Power. So I really look forward to how they do that. That's probably top of my list. There are about a million other things I'm looking forward to.
But what do you, I mean, I'm going to throw up some more of the, while I ask you this question, I'm going to throw some of the demo reels for some of these companies so people can see more of these. There's a ton of these reels and companies involved. When it comes to channeling, do you want them to follow the canon of the book, or do you want them to just kind of like, just go at it and do something really, really spectacularly cool that it might not be exactly what you see in the books?
Yeah, good question. I personally don't care if they're accurate. Like, oh, healing has to be earth, wind, and whatever. Like, I don't personally care about that. I just want to see cool, flowy stuff happening and things happen. Now, I do think in certain instances, a weave of fire probably needs to look like some sort of fiery weave, right? But I'm not going to be so concerned about that personally. It's like Doctor Strange. People who read the comics probably see the different random symbols that appear in front of them when they do their like shield things in Doctor Strange. To me, that just looks cool. I don't know what it means. I don't know if that actually comes from the comics or if that's artist creative liberty. To me, that doesn't matter. It just looks awesome, you know?
Yeah, and that is one thing that Rafe said. And by the way, I'm showing the demo reel by Automatic, I think it's, and they're just doing this, just showing this kind of layered approach to this one scene. It's so cool.
Amazing. It was awesome. And shout out to Geeky Airy for putting a lot of this together. She sent me a link of she's done a lot of sleuthing and she found on IMDb, there's like 36 different entries in the Wheel of Time stuff on IMDb of different studios and or artists who have been working on it, who are actually listed on IMDb, which is not complete. So I think we already know of like, is it 8 studios working on Wheel of Time or something?
I think there was at least 10 in that list.
It's amazing.
Yeah. If you don't follow Geekieri and WattSeries.com, you should. You can follow them on social media. I'll make sure that their links are in the description of this video. And Geekieri has her own YouTube channel. So you can go find the Brown Aja Detective on YouTube. She's done some amazing breakdowns of each of the episodes. Looks like we have 4 people in queue for calling. Oh, wow. So we'll be able to bring some people in here shortly. As far as myself, as what I'm looking forward to, I think channeling is really cool.
Definitely.
But I'm hopeful they're going to use the, you know, mostly I would assume VFX here to really give the world a feel like it's huge. Like I want to believe, you know, when Robert Jordan talks about populaces, the size of a population in Tarvalon or in Camelin, they're huge.
Yeah.
Like it should not feel like you're just kind of like taking a, I don't know. It shouldn't feel like you're just riding a horse into a town of 5,000 people.
Right.
Like it should feel like tens Epic. Of thousands. Yeah. I want it to feel so big. I mean, hundreds of thousands of people. I want it to feel like millions of people in this. Like I want to believe there are millions and millions and millions and millions of people in this world. And it's, you know, and it's a thriving, you know, for the Tarvalon, like a thriving metropolis, you know.
Right.
It should not feel, and it better not feel. That's the small. One, like, yeah, that's going to bug me. I think channeling and all those things, sure, I might be annoyed by something. But if the world feels small, I think that's going to just kill me.
You know, I have to say, I am not a fan of The Witcher books. I haven't read The Witcher books or played the video games at all. But I watched The Witcher on Netflix. I enjoyed it a lot. But one of the things I felt from that was how it felt very small. I never felt like I knew geographically where any of these different cities were. I never felt like anyone lived in the cities. Like it felt small to me. And maybe in some ways that was an artistic choice to make it kind of feel like this is about a few certain characters, you know, but I agree with you. That's one of the few things that concerns me about some of Rafe's answers is they've had to cut out a lot of the villages and different things. I hope that's because they're trying to save some of those bigger set pieces and VFX things for the bigger cities or whatever. But I have to agree completely. Like it better feel epic and huge. And, you know, this is something that the first few seasons of Game of Thrones did well. The traveling took forever to get from point A to point B. In the last few seasons, it's like everyone knew how to fast travel. And the funny thing is Robert Jordan figured out a way to make that work in book with certain elements that I won't spoil. You know, fast traveling actually was a thing in the Wheel of Time after a while, but that wasn't the case in Game of Thrones. People just suddenly were halfway across the continent in 15 minutes, you know, and that kind of ruined some of that immersion for me.
Yeah. And Alex pointed this out in chat, you know, big worlds are expensive. That's where I'm hoping, like you said, I'm hoping the trade-off was we're not going to see every stop on the Matt and Rand journey. Yeah. But the world's going to feel big because I absolutely 100% agree with this about The Witcher. It felt small. It felt like set pieces. Like I felt like they were just like, they would do that's like, now we're going to go to the Citadel. And they would do like the same shot of, Citadel. I don't know what it is. It's just some building. It's like, show me a building.
Right.
And then there's people in a room in a building somewhere. I'm hoping that Witcher season 2, I'm still going to watch it. I'm hoping that they got more budget and they put it towards actually kind of making it feel a bit more epic. But I don't know The Witcher story. I don't know The Witcher world. So, again, maybe that's not the deal. Sorry, go ahead.
Before I was going to say, in the books, too, that's a big deal to the characters. They leave Emmons Field, which is this small village, and then they see Taren Ferry, and they're like, wow, this place is kind of big. And then they see Barlone, and they're like, whoa, this place is huge. And then, you know, they're like, oh, this is a real city. And Tom is kind of making fun of them, you know. Like,
each time, yeah.
When they go to Shadar Logoth. One of the things I love about Shadar Logoth is it's not just this old, dead, scary city. It's huge. It's massive. Yeah. It's like Camelin sized, you know?
Yeah, so that's what I like about the concept art suggested that, right? And so I'm hoping that they carry that through. That's where I'm hoping the visual effects really does a great job. Like, you've seen some of these layering effects. Now, like I said, we have four people in queue. It looks like we'll bring our first caller in. It's someone that the Wheel of Time here, the Dusty Wheel, our viewers know very well. Welcome to the Dusty Wheel, Norm. How you doing tonight?
Great innkeeper, as always. I raise my mug and glass to you. And, of course, Lauren, cheers. My red-headed buddy. What's up, dude? I raise my glass to you. And, of course, everyone in chat. What's up?
It's awesome to have you here. Oh, you're putting it back on? Nice.
I'm going to put this back on for you, Norm. You can do that if you want.
It was like the best beginning. So, Norm, what are your thoughts, man? What are your thoughts about special visual effects? What's your question for Lauren?
Honestly, okay, I want it to grow exponentially, you know, gradually. I don't want it to be full board to the point where it is just a CG OD. You know what I mean? I mean, I'm a fan of practical effects that are mixed with the, you know, CG and stuff that you have. So I think I want, one, the channeling to be awesome. I mean, I think all of us want that. But when it comes to, you know, the cities and the other aspects and stuff, I want that to build naturally, you know, using the surroundings and stuff, you know, the portal stones and the waves, I want the waves to be so black that, you know, you light a match in there and you could barely see anything. I mean, I want to know how visually they can pull that off. And then Mach and Shin has got to scare the bejesus out of you. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, and also the Mashadar as well. That has to just freak you out as if like a blob is coming over to try to kill you or something, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the kind of aspects that I'm looking forward to. And then when we get the second season is when you can start getting bigger, you know? Because mm-hmm. that's when we start getting into, you know, Falma and all these other places that are bigger, and also to these different areas in the portal stones and stuff like that are just bigger, you know, that's when I want to see it grow. And then when it gets to season 3 and season 4, God willing, then you can open up everything wider, you know, because otherwise it's going to be too big, too fast. And the lay person will not, you know, be as invested because it's like, oh, it's too much. I can't figure it out. You know, like you said, Morin, you know, first 3 seasons of Game of Thrones, you know, it was perfect the way it was. One, because it followed the books, but two, you know, they didn't OD you on the special effects. So that's what I want to see with Watt.
So my only concern there is kind of what we just addressed, which is you can't go so slow that you look like The Witcher. You know, you have to still give us, you know, deep world building. It has to still feel like you're part of this, you know, larger world. But I agree, they don't have to kind of overdose. I'll agree with you there, which is, I don't need them to do these, like you said, going over every city and, you know, showing millions of people, blah, blah, blah. I don't need that. But if they're going to go to Tar Valon, it can't look like it's some podunk city somewhere, right? Like it can't, if they're going to big cities, it has to look big. Like it can't, they can't go, I guess my point is they can't cut that part out. So I think I'm leaning towards what you're saying. I don't think I'm fully on board there, but I'm close.
Yeah. My thought is I completely agree, Norm. Like as fun as VFX are, I love these giant epic scenes and movies and stuff. You should do that when it's appropriate and you should never overdo it. You shouldn't overplay your hand. Like I think, there's a concept in movie making that often monsters are scarier when you don't see them. It's the unknown. It's the lack of it that's scarier. Once you see it, it kind of takes away some of that fear. And so we're going to see things like Trollocs, but I hope that they do kind of minimize that, that they're not overdoing it just to be like flexing or to say like, look what we can do. I do want it to be gradual. There are just certain moments that where I want them to save their budget for those moments. You know, another example of this, and again, this is probably spoilers, but
how deep is the spoiler?
Well, I'll say vaguely, the columns in Ruidian, like that sequence and some of the things that happen there, I want those to be big spectacles. Some of them, you know, some of them don't need to be, but that's where they need to save their money. And that kind of timing wise, that'll probably be what, season three or four. So I think that they can
I think I agree with you both there, which is, you know, I don't need it to be overwhelming. I just need them to have spent enough that I buy in. That's what I'm looking for.
Yeah.
Hey, Norm, as always, man, awesome to have you here. I can't remember for what I asked you last time you called, but what is the one special effect or visual effect you're looking forward to? It has to just be one. What are you looking forward to most when the show comes out?
I'm not sure if you guys talked about it, but for me, quite honestly, sword forms. I want great sword play. That's what's going to sell me. I want, you know, boar rushes down the mountain to look like somebody charging about to, you know, gut somebody, you know, disembowel somebody. I mean, some really good sword forms. That's what I'm probably looking forward to the most.
Okay.
I love
it. I like it. I like it, man. Hey, have a good one. It's awesome always to hear your voice. Glad the call lines were open tonight and glad you called, man. Talk to you soon.
Hey, and we'll see you guys tomorrow late.
Yeah, we'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Has Rafe answered any questions about sword forms? I can't remember if that's been talked about.
I don't know. I can't remember. It doesn't sound familiar that he gave an answer about sword forms.
It might be a good thing to ask him again.
But people might have asked, and he might have said something like, you know, he might have been like, I love sword forms. In other words, I don't remember there being some kind of detail from the show, but I think somebody has asked something about swords. By the way, we have three more callers. We'll take these calls. We'll get some final thoughts here. While we were talking, I threw up a video for one of the demo reels. You'll see this happen if you're watching the show right now. I'm going to throw up some demo reels while we're talking, which is just all the remaining companies that we know are part of the Wheel of Time on Amazon Prime and their demo reels. They're a lot of fun to kind of consider just from a quality standpoint. And before I show another one of those, let me welcome Jonathan to the show. Jonathan, welcome to the Dusty Wheel. How are you doing tonight?
Hi. Yeah, thanks for having me on.
Absolutely.
I just want to follow up with what Norm was saying about the slow roll. I agree, and I would specifically narrow it to just the magic itself, because I know Warren was talking about pouring money into and kind of focusing the limited funds on special effects, which I think is the right way to go too. Except for, you know, I think it would actually be more complicated and harder to do it where we got it mostly from the effects of non-channelers who couldn't see weaves. Because as you were saying earlier, Warren, you know, you would have to do all of the effects of a fire or air, but not, you know, be able to cover it up with magic and neon lights and stuff like that. And so be more subtle. And also that's a way of kind of like easing us into the experience, and 98% of the world, you know, sees it that way. That, you know, I would even go so far as to say, if we did not see a weave until like the last episode of the first season, I would be okay with that. Now, if we go to Tar Valon or whatever, then I hope neon lights are shooting from the walls. You know? I hope it's Technicolor everything, but, so that's kind of my point. To answer the question about which effect I'm most curious of, I think men's viewings, especially in later seasons, I would have a different answer. But in the first book, I think men's viewings are the most unique, you know, so I'm most curious how they do that. And if they just have like an emoji on people's heads, I think you could easily do that wrong, you know, and silly. So I hope it's not silly, because men's ability is really cool and unique.
Yeah. That's a good one. I like that one. Because they can kind of play with that one a bit. You know, they might have more fun with that. This came up, Lauren. You brought this up when you're watching something like The Witcher, and you don't really know the history behind it. You're just excited because if you're engaged with something that looks interesting. So right. I do wonder how much they're going to lean into. Most people are not going to know anything about the books and are not going to worry about little things that maybe fans will be like, oh, this is wrong, but it's more visually compelling or visually interesting. So I do wonder if they something like the viewings, like Jonathan's bringing up, that they'll kind of play with that a bit more than what we get in the books.
Yeah. I hadn't even thought about men's viewings, but now I'm really excited to see how they do that. I mean, you're absolutely right, though. These are the kinds of things that could make or break it. Another thing that I think about is how are they going to do talking wolves in parents.
Right.
You know, that's one of those things where
there's there's a lot of things that could be very silly, right?
Right.
Yeah, that's a great question. Yeah, that one's a good one to have brought up. Hey, Jonathan, thank you very much for waiting, and thank you for your question, man.
Yeah,
we'll talk to you soon, okay?
Thank you.
Yep, bye-bye.
Bye.
So I did, I saw Glenn before I bring our last two callers in. I don't think Taylor is there to do this for me right at this moment, but there are a variety of questions that Rafe answered when he talked about set design. And And these questions that he answered actually cover a lot of things that we've been talking about and answer questions about the swords. Taylor, is that something you can throw up for us, or should I just read them off? If you just have a moment. Yeah. We'll bring our next caller, and then we'll go through these answers with people on, you know, while we're here. So let's bring in our next caller. Welcome, Troy, to the Dusty Wheel. Troy, how are you doing tonight?
Hey, man, it's been a while.
yeah, man, it's been a while for sure. So I do recognize your voice. Hey, so how you been?
Oh, pretty good.
Good. Just
been doing a lot of other stuff.
Good, man. What are your thoughts?
I was going to talk about the budgets and how the actual effects and the... Because I did pyrotechnics in a couple. Hmm.
Gotcha.
Low budgets, and I do reenactments, and I've worked with some on some higher budget ones. That depends on the danger to the people around you, or the structure. It's like if you're going to do a bombing run over JFK Airport, they're gonna take an overlay JFK Airport with you doing a bombing run someplace else.
Right. Yeah.
So you're using a CGI for both sides of it, just putting one to the other. If you want a specific color in it, you have to use specific metals. It's a really, really interesting part. Now, if you're working with people, then you have to go through a process of marking out areas where people have to stop and timing, etc. So people don't get hurt, but you're still visual effects there.
That's right. So what do you hope they do, Troy, when it comes to pyrotechnics? Are you hoping to see like a lot of, you know, practical effects when it comes to the, you know, explosions?
They're going to have to do certain forms of practical. They'll take like certain shots of like rolling earth and fire. They'll take explosions and use explosions behind them with like either fuel or some form of fuel and make that roll, that fire roll.
Right.
With it.
You were mentioning the cost of this, as far as pyrotechnics, is it an expensive, practical effect when it comes to movies?
It depends on the how big the explosion is, and it's not really that expensive, because most of the shows today, you're doing your explosives away from the scene.
Right. Gotcha. Okay. They can film it there, and then they can just like the composite side of things with that Lauren was talking about.
Yeah.
Right? I gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. What's really fun with it is if you make a mistake. We did one. We were blowing up a van.
Okay.
And one guy left his sunglasses in it, and it flew out the window.
That's awesome.
And another part of it is like if you're doing a scene like that, you've got to take things apart. You got to loosen up all the nuts and bolts and everything so things fly.
Right.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah. I didn't even think about that.
So I was just trying to give what it takes, part of what it takes to do it in the natural scene.
Yeah. That's very cool.
I love that perspective. A show that I enjoy watching is Mythbusters, and they'll always lead up to the point where they blow stuff up. That seems like that's what they do in that show, right? And the measures they take to be very careful and safe is really kind of impressive. And I imagine on like a big budget show where you've got actors and people around and stunt people and all this other stuff, they're taking that to the next level. They're probably EMTs on site, ready to go to put douse out fires or to help people. Like, it's a big deal. I'm sure it's very expensive to get all of that stuff coordinated, right? And so it is easier in some instances to just shoot it on a back lot somewhere with a green or blue screen behind it and composite it later, right?
Yeah.
It is much easier.
Hey, Troy, thank you so much. It's awesome to hear your voice, man. And thank you for sharing your experience in pyrotechnics. I really appreciate that.
All right.
Hey, before you go, let me ask you that one question that I've asked everyone else here. Is there a particular special or visual effect that you're looking forward to in the series when it comes out on TV? Is there one in particular you can't?
Yes, there is a particular type of special effect that I'm looking forward to. And it's a broader one. They're going to do the darkness of the ways, and when they go into the portal stones and changing your perspective and making you feel like you're in another place.
Yeah.
That
I agree.
Broadness of that. That's one I'm looking forward to.
Yeah.
The waves is going to be interesting.
Yeah, I agree. I agree. I hadn't even kind of gone to the ways. I agree. That one I can't wait for too. That's going to be awesome. Hey, Troy, as always, man, thank you very much for calling in. We'll talk to you soon. Okay.
You bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye.
Yeah, good points made around there. We have, like I said, one last caller. Then we're going to go to this Watt Series website and talk about the answers that Rafe had, because it kind of deals in CGI. It deals with that sword question we had. And last thoughts from Lauren, and we'll close up shop for tonight. Let's bring in our final caller to the show. Welcome, Ice Pepper Aja. How you doing tonight?
Hello. Fantastic.
Awesome. What's up?
Well, I had questions regarding slow motion. I'm kind of excited about the different things they can do. I don't know if that's expensive or more difficult to add special effects to, but I think I was the person that kind of freaked out when the footage was released, and I thought that the Trolloc was having a seizure a bit because he was moving so fast, I felt, in comparison to Moraine, and I just try to picture different things that they can do with timing and slowing down the weaves to see them, slowing down sword motions. I'm just wondering if you guys have any scenes that you think would be great for slow motion.
Ooh, that's a great question. Yeah, anything coming to mind for you?
Well, I got to say, you're absolutely right. That scene with the Trolloc, one of the things that people pointed out to me and that I talked about in my video about it was it almost feels like the frame rate for Moraine in the foreground is different from the frame rate, meaning how many frames per second there are, which gives that feeling of it being in slow motion or sped up. It almost seems like the background elements of Lan and the Trolloc were different speeds than Moraine in the foreground. And I can't help but feel like that was an artistic choice. You know, like there's all this crazy stuff going on in the background. They're fighting, maybe it's winter night. And then Moraine is just like calming herself, embracing the true source, and she's ready to let loose on these Trollocs. Like, it kind of feels like it was intentional. And I like that. I like the idea of having these sort of like slow character focused moments when something impactful like channeling for the first time is happening. And I think another great place where they could do that is, assuming they do this, and again, spoilers for the Eye of the World, you know, when Rand sort of has some of his dizzy spells after he's reacted to having channeled, right? Like, I love the idea of seeing the camera almost like change angles and slow down, and you almost like hear heartbeats or something, you know, just giving it this sense of him having these different strange things happening to him. I also think battle scenes, you got to see some slow motion in that. Not a lot, not over the top, but I would love to see some like Trollocs and Murdral charging in almost like a slow, steady pace. There's a great episode in Game of Thrones called Battle of the Bastards, which has some of the most like heart, it like really made my heart pump, the intensity of some of the battle scenes. And they do a really good job of messing with speed and making it feel like the characters on the battlefield are suffocating almost. And I hope that they make a lot of creative choices like that in the show.
Yeah. One of the ones I'm looking forward to, I think, yeah, has to be near the end. I think at least what I imagine is the end when it comes to the Eye of the World. I think Rand and channeling, I could see some slow-mo opportunities there mm-hmm. that would slow things down, right? Just for everything that's happening. You can almost see some Trollocs charging. You can almost, you know, you can see a lot of this happening just slowly and Rand coming to some awareness and channeling. I would love to see channeling slowly, you know, see the weaves somehow, maybe those first, or even just the effects of what he's doing in a right. slow way. I think that could be a really, really powerful way of using slow-mo.
Yeah, the void, someone mentioned in the comments, the void. Like, you almost need to see the wings on a bird slow down or the rain droplets slowing or something. There could be some really interesting artistic things they could do with that as well, where in those moments when they enter the void, everything around them kind of slows and stills. It'd be really cool.
Yeah, I wonder if they would use it even like a slow-mo effect with Balefire. You know, I could potentially, I could see the, you know, burning someone out of the pattern in a slow-mo shot could be pretty cool.
That could look really cool.
I don't know. In my head, I'm seeing it be kind of cool. And almost showing the effect of Balefire happening real time, which is as the person's burning out of the pattern, seeing something that they affected reappear at the same time.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know. That would be, I think that'd be cool.
That's giving me like, not Interstellar. What was the latest Christopher Nolan movie? Tenet vibes.
Yeah,
where
yeah.
you have some things going in reverse while other things are going forward. Really cool.
Yeah, for sure. Hey, Ice Pepper Aja, thank you very much. Your answer, I'm assuming, to the question I've been asking everyone is just like slow-mo effects. But I'll ask the question, is there a particular special or visual effect that you can't wait for and to see on screen when it comes to the show?
Just any kind of weaving, I think. I mean, at some point, the complexity of certain weaves, some sort of recipe, so to speak, I think that'd be really fun. But you guys gave me a whole bunch of new ideas, so I'm super pumped.
Awesome. Well, thank you again for calling. I really appreciate you being our final caller of the night, and look forward to having you back here at the Dusty Wheel. Have a good one.
Thanks so much.
Yep, thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay,
very cool question. I haven't thought about like slow motion. That's a great one.
So let's go through these relatively quickly. We'll Taylor, if you want to show these questions, and we're just gonna scroll through them. I saw a couple here, and I thought I would just make note of which ones they are. But they were talking about the sword design, and one of the questions it was, you know, have you filmed any of the pre-production design? So go ahead. This next one here. Have you filmed any of the pre-production design, manufacturing, props, et cetera, for behind the scenes program? And he's like, yes, can't wait. Amazing team has been picking up as much as they can in the process. So after the show's aired, you can see all the work and love that went into creating these details, large and small. That's really great to hear. This next question, since we're on the topic of swords and some of the inspirations for armor design, is there quite a bit of variation between Andorran and Shannarian armor? Tay, I'm going to scroll there just a little bit. He said, yes, our costume team led by an amazing Isis Musadin started by building a map of the entire Wheel of Time world, carving out what each nation culture looked like to make sure they're differentiated, and then diving back into Two Rivers. So that's, cool. Again, really exciting. How do you decide what needs to be physically made, like the sword, and what's going to be effects? He said, I want things to be as real as possible, so in any place that we possibly can, we've built things instead of trusting to effects. Our show could be all green screen, all CGI, but I think you'll be surprised by how much of it was actually built and touched and held by our actors, which I thought goes really along with what we just said tonight. Weapons and their individual characteristics are integral to particular characters, especially with Matt, Rand, and Perrin. Will the show give a similar focus, or will the weapons mostly just be there? Ray said, you can't even imagine the number of hours that goes into each person's weapon. I was in at least 20 meetings about the dagger that Egwene has, and that's not even a major weapon in the books. There's a whole team of people. We have a few big book fans on the props team. Looking at every item held by an actor in the show, I'd be shocked if less than 10,000 woman man hours were spent on the design and creation of the Harrenmark sword.
Amazing.
Will there be different styles of swords, Harrenmark swords, or all of them be in katana style? Many, many different styles. That's great to hear. Will Moiraine's staff, this is where he says no. So you can go to the next one, Taylor. How is the set for Two Rivers designed architecturally? It would seem to make it homely and medieval, but because of its location history, are there any other inspirations? Rave said when the books came out, they felt so blazingly fresh and different and new, so we want that same thing to be true in the show. And if you see us leaning away from certain elements in the books, oftentimes it's because audiences have now seen them before. Unfortunately, sometimes even in cases where the book to screen adaptations are from books that cribbed it from Wheel of Time. Ha! And then the music they asked about, we don't have to, we can cover that one later. How are the sword forms? This is gonna finally gets us to that question. How are the sword forms going to be presented? Is the style going to be pulled from a specific region or of sword fighting, or are they going to be spread out over many regions? He said, we have a fight time and sword master on the show who has built a fighting style unique to each weapon and culture. So if you see a Borderlander fight with a Harrenmark blade, it may feel different than a Seanchan. That's merely hypothetical, of course. Well, thank you, Taylor, for throwing that up for us. So that answers your question. Hopefully, Norm, I think we are going to get that. I do like the Harrenmark blades. I had forgotten that he said there's many, many different styles. Because people are like, that's not the same exact version of this. I like that, you know, the version that may be in the books will possibly show up somewhere else. You know what I mean? We're going to get different styles of the Harrenmark blade. So I love that aspect of those answers. Okay, Lauren, thank you so much for showing up, man. Any final notes about special or visual effects? Anything we forgot to tell the audience here? And any final thoughts for you about the show?
I forgot about that Q&A. That got me hyped. That was great.
Yeah, right?
You know, I wanted to say one last thing. I was watching a documentary called Life After Pi, which you can watch on YouTube. I'd highly recommend it. If this is a subject that interests you and you want to learn more about the VFX industry, it's only 30 minutes. You can watch it on YouTube. And it's about when Life of Pi came out, that movie won for the Academy Award for Best Picture. And I think they won Best Visual Effects as well. And there was a big controversy at the time because at the moment that they were winning the Academy Award for you know, some of the most amazing, most incredible visual effects you've ever seen, that the company that did the visual effects was going bankrupt and shutting down and all the employees were being fired. And it was this really sort of sad juxtaposition of the people who did all the work not getting the credit that they so rightly deserved, losing their jobs, while some of the big wigs in Hollywood were making all the money. And it's a really fascinating watch. And they also talk about some of the VFX. But one of the things that stood out to me in that and in doing research for this episode is this idea that when I make my videos, I worry about the details. I worry that I didn't do it super well. I'm constantly comparing my standard of work to big budget Hollywood work. And, you know, in that documentary, the guy who runs the studio, who's been doing these incredible visual effects for decades, he says, I don't even know how we do it. It's magic to me. And that really stood out to me because it's movie magic, and it isn't done by one individual. Movies don't come about because one passionate person makes it. I mean, you do have some movies like that, but it's rare. It's a team of dedicated people working tirelessly to bring these incredible things to life for us. And it's a weird thing, but it kind of like comforts me when I am hard on myself for my work. I'm just one guy doing my channel, you know, and I can be hard on myself. And then I watch these movies and I'm like, man, I want to do stuff like that. And then I realize, no, this is hundreds or maybe thousands of people making this thing happen and come to life. And that gives me a lot of comfort. So I guess I would just end on saying it's movie magic. It's an awesome thing. I love it so much, and I can't wait to see my favorite book series come to life. And let's not be too harsh on the VFX when it does.
but when it does, Lauren's gonna break it all down. That's right.
I'll be harsh channel. Because I have to for my channel, right?
For the channel. That's just for the channel.
Right.
Hey, thank you, Lauren. It was awesome. What a great way to end this. Yeah, please do. I think I've seen the Bard of the Red Hand put Lauren's link in the chat here. Like I said, it's in the description of the video. Also, go follow Lauren's stuff. Go support what he's doing. It's a lot of fun. I love seeing your videos. Do you want to give a sneak peek? Anything coming out soon that fans can expect before we let you go tonight?
I have three scripts that I have written but are kind of being edited at the moment. I have some really great Wheel of Time fans and friends on my Discord who are kind of helping me edit some of my scripts. So my next three planned are one called Light and Shadow, Everything We Know About the Creator and the Dark One for new fans as part of my Watt 101 series. And then I have one about Sidin and one about Sidar that are scripted that I've actually written the scripts for. I have about a dozen other ones planned, you know, talking about Shadowspawn, specifics about Trollocs, Murdral, Aes Sedai, the White Tower, all kinds of stuff. My goal is to just have a huge library of Watt 101 content so that when the show comes out and new fans start Googling Wheel of Time, hopefully they'll find a spoiler-free or spoiler-light channel on YouTube where they can learn these things without getting spoiled. So tell your friends, people who are excited about the show but maybe haven't read the books, let them know about my channel. And hopefully once they start watching the show, they can use my channel for reference. That's the goal. So,
yeah, absolutely. It's a lot of fun. Lauren and I have collaborated on a bunch of those. I just don't have enough time in the day anymore to help help on the details. I love you're doing the 101s because I feel less concerned about canon issues.
And yeah, and if there are, you know, inconsistencies or if I get something wrong in the canon, it's Matt's fault.
It's my fault or I'll point it out. That's what I like to do. I just like to go to Lauren like, I don't know, man. Hey, thank you very much for being here, man. Thank you for putting this all together. Hopefully you enjoyed this. Taylor, thanks from the on production side of this. Taylor's on back there making stuff happen, getting all these assets available for us. Hopefully you all enjoyed that. Hopefully this was a visually enjoyable episode here at the Dusty Wheel. And be back tomorrow. We're talking with Brandon Sanderson. That's right. Show up at 8 p.m. Eastern. That'll be live. And yeah, we'll be talking with him all about the Wheel of Time and all of his other works. It should be a lot of fun. I'll be prepping for that all day tomorrow. My goal is to make it really, really enjoyable and new, not something that you've seen before or questions you've heard before. So please do come back and please do like this video on the way out. We do a show in Discord after this. We get together and talk. If you have any comments, you can jump in there and keep the conversation going. I probably will not be able to get there today. Like I said, I got to go prep for Brandon Sanderson's show tomorrow. So, okay, that's it, everybody. Thank you very much for being with us here tonight. I know there's no Wheel of Time TV show news, but hopefully this was enjoyable and you loved meeting the Blue Man group of the Wheel of Time. Okay, that's it, Lauren. Thank you for being here. And as we say around here, good night and smash to black. You went right to kill it. Look at you, you're already. You're just done. I mean, this is like
And now I'm like, great, my turn.
And if you don't like that, you wanted to say, well, Robert Jordan could have made the two rivers all white. He could have. But he didn't.
So okay. Just complimented me on my dress, and as you can clearly see, I'm
sad. I see Lukomi as something along the lines of a Shidar Haran analog.
It does make sense why it outlasted the breaking.
Yeah.
See, consistently why I have Therese in the show, because she's going to correct everything that
Hey, everybody, welcome to the Dusty Wheel Show. What? Meme Off Challenge. Yay!
Terrible, like, baby face mounted on, like, a huge body. So, like,
this
all
is
of
not
sudden,
just like, a traditional fantasy, right? There are sci-fi
and
elements.
And just a moment ago, kind of Rafe tweeted something. So let me get my guests in here with me. And
probably,
let's,
I would
let's
say,
get, let's
put in 70-80% of the work. I got to be over the shoulder and be like, no.